So good morning, Sonali. So nice to have you with us today. We're going to be discussing a topic which is becoming more and more relevant every day. So I'm looking forward to our chat, and you know, I'm sure that we will all learn something very insightful today from you. So let's begin by you telling us a little bit about yourself, what you do, how did you get into this field, you know? Yeah.
Sure. Thanks, KK, and it's been a pleasure connecting with you. And I'm so happy that we can together share this platform and reach out to a lot of parents who have been traumatized about how to protect their children online. So similarly, this journey of responsible netizen started as a parent not understanding how to safeguard my own daughter when she was in school and using online platforms. While she was cyberbullied and threatened by people and friends around her, we realized that there is no place to go to. Not that it's any great today, but back then it was really, really very difficult to kind of address online distress or even report or understand what needs to be done. So we friends came together and realized that we all need to work towards online safety. But we also realized that everybody needs to take onus of their online behavior. It cannot even entrust that responsibility to somebody else. And which is why Responsible Netizen was actually born. We are a non-profit and we work only on education on online safety within Maharashtra now with the Ministry of Education and with Maharashtra Cyber, because we are also a referral organization that refers cases for legal interventions or for psychological support for people, children and parents facing any online distress. And so the journey has been pretty adventurous, because we are still the only non-profit committed to online child online protection with the cause that we run. But the issue is extremely vast, and it needs a lot of multi-level approach interventions. But we've stuck to children, and we've stuck to being able to protect only children in cyberspace, and so that's been our journey so far.
So tell me some of the types of crimes that you see against being committed against children. Is there child pornography, or is there a wide variety of crimes? Because we're not really familiar with all the stuff that can happen.
So when we started working with schools about in 2012 and 13, we realized there's an entire set of crimes that happen with children, ranging from account hacking to creating of fake profiles, to cyber bullying, or even stalking and morphing done by slightly older children, which I mean 7-8 graders. But the more severe forms of cybercrime for sure are grooming, or probably CSAM that we call today, or even sextortion and revenge porn, which we've seen happening in schools at grade 8 and 9. Again, the entire gamut of cybercrimes is so vast. And we've realized that children, A, are absolutely unaware about legal implications of cyber crimes. They're also not aware of consequences of their own online behavior. So our concern is that children are extremely adventurous in cyberspace, and they are very cool about it. So obviously, because we call the new TQ, which is the technology quotient, is very high in children. And it is below poverty line with adults. So that divide between what parents know today and what children know today is extremely huge, which is why bringing them together, we can't be at par with our kids when technology is discussed, but at least we can understand bit of what needs to be done to protect them in cyberspace. So when we talk of cybercrimes, we're not only having experiences of children being vulnerable to it, we're also having a lot of experiences where children are committing cybercrime. For instance, at 4 onward, we have an entire set of children. I think our research says about 60% children have attempted hacking at least once. And the most commonly hacked platform is Bajuwale Uncle Ka Wi-Fi. And this is a statement that kids issue with great pride, with great confidence, because they are damn good at it. And it's also considered a prestige issue. So if I have not hacked any account in grade 5 and 6, I kind of don't have its respect in class. So it begins really very early. But with grooming, we've seen children very young also witnessing these kind of various forms of strangers entering their lives online. In fact, with these experiences today, we've realized that strangers and predators have access to children more online than offline today because of the numerous platforms that they're using, and they're absolutely unaware about safety or even preventive measures on those platforms. One another concerning area for us is addiction to devices. And so be it gaming, or we've had a lot of cases where children have experienced severe forms of bullying, or various forms of hacking of profiles, children getting into deep web, dark web at grade 7 and 8, children trading with drugs into deep web at grade 9. So all of these are happening, and these are happening around us, but A, we are not aware. Two, children don't know what to do about it, because the moment they disclose it to their parents, unka phone haath se nikal jane wala hai. So it is better not to talk about it at all. Right. But there's been a huge experience in terms of what all children are vulnerable to and what they're also committing in cyberspace.
Excellent. Now, Shivali, you gave us a very nice 20,000 feet overview, and I was making some notes with some of the terms that you introduced, which might be, at least some of those are alien to me as well. So I would like to, you know, go into each one of these. For example, you mentioned grooming. Could you tell us what is this act, and, you know, how is it, how are children exploited when we talk about this term of grooming?
Child online grooming is a phenomenon where a stranger approaches a child on an internet platform, usually through chat, through games, where the stranger has access to a child. And the idea is to groom, to tayar karna, to be very, very basic in terms of how to gain trust of the child, become very, very friendly with the child, and then gradually and very, very slowly introduce age-inappropriate content. So to give you an example of siblings 7 and 9 who used to play a couple of games online when their parents were at home or probably at work, and there was a pop-up suddenly which says, "Hi, how are you?" And these kids were very thrilled, and they clicked on that, and then they started chatting and with this person. This person happened to be a slightly older man, and he started communicating with these two of them and started sharing a lot of jokes, started sharing a lot of things they would be interested in, sharing gifts virtually, and gained complete trust of these two kids. After a while, and then they started having secrets amongst each other, you know, so this is something that you don't have to share with anybody. And the entire period, parents were unaware, because this was supposed to be a conversation which was confidential between them and the person. And every time this man kept telling the children that, you know, this is something which is absolutely normal. There is nothing wrong in it. So there is no reason to kind of report or inform. And so that trust was completely gained. After a while, he came in shirtless on the webcam, and kids were, you know, bursting out of laughter. But they also realized that their father or their grandfather at home also, you know, is usually shirtless at home. So that's absolutely okay. Now he's a friend, so that we can definitely trust. Very gradually, this person started introducing pornographic clips to the children. First, it began with images, and children were obviously curious to understand what that was. And in one of these certain chat conversations where a video was being played, the mother happened to walk inside, and she almost threw a fit of rage to see what was happening and who they were talking to and what was the situation like. So while this was reported, this was about two or three years ago, reported to the CyberCell. And then the entire thing was reported. I believe POXO back then was not as strong as this. And so, though the case was reported, the investigations went on, and I think the person was also caught. But this racket is huge, and you know, there is 100% access to children through these platforms. So grooming is to actually prepare the child, to trust the child completely, and then very, very gradually initiate conversations around sexuality, around pornography, seek images, seek live conversations, live streaming videos, and take that content and then start making the child feel guilty and therefore give in to whatever demands are made by the person. Mm-hmm. So this is a process which is it is one of the severest forms of crime in cyberspace, obviously, but it is also people are not wanting to believe that this can happen to their children, which is another area of threat for us.
And Sonali, you mentioned POSCO. So I think for our international audience, POSCO is the Indian Prevention of Sexual Crimes Against Children Act, right? That's the one.
Yes.
Yeah. And so,
Go ahead.
I know this would be a question probably that we should talk to somebody, you know, a lawyer or somebody from a legal background. But to your information, does POSCO adequately cover online crimes like grooming or anything else?
Yes, absolutely. In fact, I would really vouch for that act for now, because it is one of the most evolved kind of acts, especially for protection of children online for our country, which is badly needed. Mm-hmm. And it also covers very, very critical elements of gestures, of words being used to intimidate children or to threaten children, which also fall in the POSCO Act. So it is very, very elaborate. It covers all aspects of child online protection and safety, and I think it is a very well developed act for now. We can definitely vouch for that.
Excellent. I also want to elaborate on the other crime or act that you mentioned, which is cyber bullying. Now we know that children get bullied inside the classroom or in the playground, and usually there is some adult around to monitor that behavior and to correct it or to intervene if it's getting out of hand. How does this translate online, and if you can narrate to us one or two of the most severe cases of cyberbullying you've seen, and what is the impact on a child's psychology because of this?
Cyberbullying now is happening at grade 2 and 3 because everybody is learning on virtual platforms. Mm. And we've had cases where children have hacked another person's video conferencing platform. They've hacked the school domain and they've kind of, declared that their school, there'll be no online class ever, and children are rejoicing on those platforms. Or very, very severe forms of threats that children have or challenged each other on such platforms where they've asked children to do certain things just to be able to fit into the group, and being ostracized is one of the biggest threats that children pose today. So being thrown out of the group or outing somebody from the group, excluding somebody from the group is a threat that they've always been very, very worried about. We've had cases where children have actually morphed images of another person, another friend of theirs, and created a very small WhatsApp group and circulated that image just because the boy was not listening to them or they wanted him to do something really nasty and dirty. This then went on to the child later on complaining, refused to go to school, was shocked seeing the image that was being circulated. And the child was actually into depression and had a panic attack and had to rush to the hospital. Later on, the child took about 6 to 8 months to not really normalize, but get back to some levels of normalcy, because he believed that everybody is seen his morphed image and he could not really face anybody. So we believe bullying happens at various platforms, through images, through text, through videos, and it's done, anybody could bully. There are no specific guidelines on who and why and where. Anybody could bully. So we talk about five important things. One is the bully needs more help, and therefore reporting is very, very critical. Two, we talk about how you definitely need to identify content related to bullying. बहुत बार ऐसा लगता है कि this is not bullying. Somebody is just teasing me, and it is okay to be teased. But while you're being teased, your derogatory words being used by other children, very, very defamatory, very, very hurtful, revengeful words being used, children need to identify that this is form of bullying. To never respond, react, or reply to any content which is bullying, which is considered bullying. So if you are being bullied and you've received a message on a chat platform or an Instagram group or wherever, you make sure that you don't respond to it, because the more you respond or react, you aggravate the discussion further. And so that is where the cutoff is important. You cut off ties with the person who's bullying you, and then that is where it begins. The other thing we talk about is reporting to a trusted adult. Now, we've been really trying to advocate for parents being this trusted adult within the child's family, but a lot of times we've realized that parents have a very policing kind of a view, or a very extremist kind of view or interventions on anything that their children probably face online. So we asked children to identify an adult, whether at school, whether in their family, whom they could trust and they could definitely report to, so that action is taken. Many a times children report this to their best friends or to their friend circle. While this is okay to report or share, we won't call it reporting, share so that you're venting out what you're feeling, but there are no solutions coming out of it because your peers also think alike you. So which is why an adult intervention is required. Fourth, most importantly, we talk to children about saving evidences of the content that has been used, which is going to be critical for a child to or an adult to intervene and take this case further. And most importantly, we empower children with the thought of being able to protect themselves and not allowing anybody else to make them feel miserable. So this is applying offline and online both. But cyberbullying has been one of the most common ways of threatening, where body shaming is used, where trolling or where they're stalked unnecessarily, morphing. So there are various ways. So all of these crimes are part of cyberbullying used by children to harass another child or their peer.
Great, great. So now when you talk about reporting, what role do you advocate that schools should take? For example, I know that the school that my kids go to, they've done some awareness sessions around this subject, but they have not advocated any helpline number, or they have not yet given any forum where a kid could approach, because as you said, kids will be very wary of approaching parents because parents may simply take away the device or take away their access from those accounts, or you know, they might overreact, as you said, extreme response might come. So should schools do more in this regard? What advice do you have for them?
Absolutely. In fact, now in the period of lockdown, we've started sharing disclaimers with schools to start airing before they start presenting, so that children and parents both know the liabilities of what their child does. And we also need to definitely tell them that while a minor commits cybercrime, the parents are legally liable to punishment. And this is something which comes in as an awakening, you know, because everybody feels kuch nahi hota and you'll never be caught. But while
kids are being kids, you know, that sort of
thing. Yeah. So it is the liability, legal liability of the parent to ensure that, you know, their child does not get involved in committing any kind of cybercrime. Moreover, we talk about, we share a lot of helpline numbers. So everybody must be aware of Childline. So 1098 is where they report to. We have our own helpline numbers. We share... the schools that we work with, we have two programs, intensive and one time. So in the intensive and one time, we have the counselor, one parent and the teacher or the principal who looks at addressing these issues. And they are the ones who report cases to us for further interventions, whether we need legal interventions, whether we need guidance on these particular platforms. Most importantly, we tell children how to report on the existing platform where they are being threatened. Unfortunately, for now, these reporting mechanisms are very, very slow, sluggish, and their community guidelines are very stringent, and they don't apply to most of the cases that come across in our context or in the Indian cultural context. So, which is when removal of content becomes very difficult. For example, if there is a child, or if we had one case where a ninth grader girl's image was morphed into a bikini and it was posted on a particular platform. So while they reported to the platform, for them, an image in a bikini was not considered against their community guidelines. So it never went off, actually.
Right.
And which is why the damage that is caused is so, so long term. It is moreover psychological. And there is no way you can intervene in terms of removing the content. So while we are definitely teaching kids to report, we are also looking at strengthening these mechanisms to be able to address those issues and provide first aid at least at the school level. So, you know, the parents are invited and discussed. Education is the only preventive tool, which is why we've been working extensively to promote online safety within schools, colleges, with parents and with children. And I think we would not want to get into the curative aspect because that has absolutely no end to it. Mm-hmm. So building on the preventive, to be able to equip, to be able to empower children to be using devices and to be using the internet responsibly is something that we definitely advocate for. So cyber hygiene practices is what we call them, and building digital guardians, so equipping parents with techniques to protect their children in cyberspace.
Yes, I will. Ask you to elaborate more on that. But there's a very relevant point that you make, which I have also faced in real life, which is that recourse to remedy in these cases is very poor. In the sense that, you know, I don't think the cops take a lot of these cyber bullying, trolling sort of cases very seriously, or they would lodge a case and investigate it to its logical end always. I mean, the police system in India is anyway very overwhelmed with lots of other stuff to do. And, you know, then there's so many hoops to jump over, in the sense that they have to coordinate with the social media company, they have to coordinate with the ISP, who themselves might not see any of this as a transgression of their community guidelines, as you said. So it's a brilliant point that you make, that prevention in this case is definitely 100 times better than the cure. The cure may never come, that content may stay online forever. And even if it's removed from one location, you know, it may still circulate on WhatsApp groups and numerous other channels. So the best is, and so that's what I want to come to now, which is that, first of all, what age is appropriate for children, for parents to have some sort of a conversation of this kind with children? I ask you this because, you know, my kids are 4 and 6. I think it's a little early. We give them very less screen time. Their screen time is limited only to their online classes. But, you know, you and I come from a background where this is a big concern. So as a parent, what's the earliest that I can broach this subject with my, let's say, you know, the elder one who's 6 now?
I would start by saying, I think we as parents are the best guides or you know, the deciding factors for what we need to introduce to our children. So my first point here is introducing age-appropriate devices, and that starts the day you introduce your device to your child. And this starts at age young as 1, because we've had cases where infants have lost vision in the eye at about 9 months, since there has been extreme screen time exposure because the baby cried. So all this has become a babysitting device and allowing parents to do whatever they want to do. So I think it is extremely challenging today for parents to understand and handle children. You know, it's been challenging, and we've never been told that parenting is a very easy task. So we have come up with our own set of challenges. But with digital platforms being introduced, it has become of a different challenge altogether. While we are managing the need to give them exposures to digital platforms, at the same time being able to control them and draw a line for them. So I think introduction of the device starts at probably 2, 3, 4, depending on the parent deciding the screen time, parents deciding the content, and parent hand-holding the child. So up till the age of 12, we talk about parents not leaving their child on their own on the device, even with parental controls in the device. So while we're giving children devices to manage with parental controls, a lot of times children break through parental controls. A lot of times children hack these platforms, and parents are least aware of it. We're also talking about using only one device sacrosanct for a child. Or probably if you're giving the child your device, then have a separate profile, and you're the expert in this space as to how you secure that one kid-friendly platform for your child in the device that you give. But I think conversation, so whatever parenting tool you use or app you use, we believe communication is the most effective parental tool that you need to begin very, very early. So we talk of not gifting a device to your child, but giving your shared device with the child, with the authority and the right to take it back when you want to, and with the right to understand what your child is doing, because you are the savior. So you will protect your child when the child falls in distress. And, you know, we've been having these conversations of privacy and, you know, I want to be alone in my room and I don't want you access my content. I think in the Indian context, our children don't get privacy, and it is our right to look after our own children, because our children are exploring, you know, amazing platforms on the internet, but they're also very vulnerable. While we talk of conversations, we have something, the Internet Family Internet Safety Contract. And we are with kids here when they talk about how rules are set only for the children in the house and parents do whatever they want. So the contract talks about screen time for everybody in the house. So there are 100 guidelines, but there are 5 or 6 critical rules that cannot be broken. For example, no device on while having meals, no devices or Wi-Fi after a certain point in the night. All of these are rules that cannot be broken, but guidelines are open, which are more inclusive, which can change depending on the situation. For example, if a child is looking at a particular project and has, you know, already finished about 30-35 minutes that is allotted, but the work is still not done, and you can allow that guideline to extend a little further, which is need-based. The other important thing we realize is involving children in making this contract and giving them the onus. So, aap bhi hamare saath. So, the rule applies to both of us, and both of us will be reprimanded as a parent and child if we break these rules. While children gain a lot of power here, they're also very manipulative, I must say. And no rule works for more than 3 days. You have to evolve something else on the fourth day. But again, I think this freedom, this is disciplining with a set of responsibility, and also with a set of understanding the liability that the child holds. So I think this only evolves over time, and there is no perfect solution for now.
Yeah, I think these ground rules are very important, because and these are now a little different. You know, previously when we had normal times and, you know, we had normal work hours and normal school hours, we had this rule that no phone when you are with family. So even when my kids were as young as 3 or 4, they used to come up and reprimand my wife if they found us on the phone. But unfortunately, at this point in time, that rule has fallen by the wayside. So they don't reprimand, they're used to it. But, you know, when I listen to you, I feel it's important to reinstitute this rule back in my household. No screen time, you know, at least after 8 o'clock or after 9 o'clock or 7 o'clock, whatever. We do follow this no devices on the table, you know, and definitely, you know, using the screen as a diversion.
I think it's also important to give them alternatives. No, so if you're telling the child hamesha saying no to devices, what are you therefore offering as an alternative? And that is a bigger challenge, because what do you offer which is as engaging and interesting as a device? And then that is something, in fact, I want to come to you and I want to ask you, how do you, you know, talk about security to kids, you know? So that's the domain that you you have an expertise in. And how do you therefore inculcate? We've had so many children talking about, "Mereko to hacker banna hai zindagi mein," and you know, so where does this start? And how do you then introduce children to these particular platforms?
Yeah, I don't know the exact answer to that yet. But as I said, my kids are still quite young, so they don't truly understand what I do for a living yet. They know that I go to work, I run a company. They don't know exactly what I do, but eventually they will learn this term about hacking and then, you know, security and things like that. So maybe a year down the line, I can answer this question for you. Sonali, I want to also talk about, you know, from a parental perspective, how does a parent identify that their kid is in trouble, that their kid could be, you know, subject to cyberbullying, for example? So what are the signs or symptoms that, you know, parents should look out for?
There are two kind of red flags that we look at. One is dependency on screen time, and these are very critical red flags. So we have a lot of cases where children have battered their parents when devices are taken away, especially when they're playing online games, and parents have been hospitalized, or parents, children have run away from homes because devices are taken away. So this doesn't happen overnight. Parents need to understand these are trends that pick up very, very fast, but there are red flags that children show which are very often missed. So raat bhar mein, this is not going to turn over into addiction, and aisa nahi hota hai. So what are the red flags for addiction? One, you can see that the child is extensively using a particular platform for very, very long durations. Two, the child's mood swings are very, very vary. So, you know, the child is very angry, irritated if the device is not given, or if the device is taken away, or very fidgety when there is no device in the hand. The child is hiding his or her own online behavior, maybe taking the device stealthily to the washroom, or keeping the phone under the pillow while everybody's seeing and accessing it. Mood swings. So three things are terribly affected: food, sleep, and academics. If there is anything other than normalcy that parents need to pick up, you know, 1 or 2 days maybe bachcha kam khana khata hai, but if this trend continues, or zyada kha raha hai khana, any changes in their normal regular behavior, is a cause for concern. Not that you need to rush to a psychiatrist or a psychologist. Please identify these trends. Look at how they evolve over the days. Observe them. It is your child. You cannot, nobody else is going to look into this matter. So if you can understand, and parents have the sixth sense of something going wrong, and I think you need to pick up those very, very strongly. With crimes that happen with children, a lot of times we've seen withdrawal, absolutely lonely, maybe crying within their rooms, or very, very aggravated and irritated and angry and throwing tantrums suddenly or out of for no reason, which is known to parents, or staying away from social interactions in the family. So these are all behaviors which are not the regular normal that you've seen your child earlier. So if there is any change in these patterns, there has to be something that needs to be discussed, picked up very, very critically. And if you feel as a parent you're unable to intervene to provide solutions or even get into a conversation, I think just seek help outside, because there is help available. There is help available around you, and we just need to tap the people that we need guidance from. While you don't do this, then you reach a stage of no return, and then things become very, very difficult to kind of bring back to normalcy. So early screening and picking up of red flags and reaching out for help. So there is nobody who's perfect. It is absolutely normal to seek help. In fact, I would like to urge to parents, while you seek help, you become a very proactive parent who is concerned about your child and is really wanting a solution for the problem that you face with your child, which you feel you're not probably compatible dealing with. So I think great when you reach out for help and you want to kind of deal with the matter.
So I think the tricky part in your answer is that some of the things you mentioned are actually also typical, behavior of a adolescent. And what you're saying more importantly is that if you have been closely watching your child, you are well aware of your child's typical behavior. If it deviates even from that weirdness of adolescence, it becomes even more weird than what it normally is, then definitely it's a big cause of concern. I think this point is great that we can reach out to organizations such as yours. We will put in the comment section, we will put the links about how we can reach out to organizations such as yours and guidance documents that I've seen on your website for parents to look out for the very things that we are speaking about. A lot of content is there on your website, so I will link to some of that relevant content as well. If let us say I'm sitting down with my kid, let's say the kid is 7 or 8 or 9, I think now is the time where maybe I cannot speak a lot about sexual crimes because I haven't spoken to my child about the birds and the bees conversation yet. But what are the sorts of things that a parent should start telling their child when it's time to have, the conversation about online security? What could be some of the 4 or 5 things that you would advise a parent should speak to their child about?
Very important. I think this is a conversation that is a must with all children. In fact, we associate with an organization called ARPAN, which specifically works on child sexual abuse online and offline. And we've learned some very critical pointers from this organization, which talk about introducing body parts to children very, very young.
Yes.
Why we always have nicknames for private parts, and the child is not able, therefore, to report what is happening to the child. So, for instance, if there is a child who is witnessing some form of abuse offline, and the child doesn't know what to call his or her own private parts, it's obviously going to be, because it's so taboo and it's considered so shameful that your child will never ever gather courage to probably speak up. In fact, in the lockdown, we've had a couple of cases where children have been approached by strangers online and offline, and there have been attempts of abuse, but the child was not able to share it because the child did not know what was happening. And the child could not understand whether what was happening was right or wrong, and that needs to be reported. So I think as young as 1 and 2, while we are having conversations about the ear, nose, eyes, hands, we also need to be introducing private organs to our children and talking about how it is important to safeguard them. And why, if we don't have these conversations with children, children are going to slightly later at 3-4, probably search on YouTube or search engine where every other, if you type S, you know EX will obviously come in later, and you'll have enough of content where children will grow up to become PhDs in content, which is actually objectionable and age inappropriate. Right. These conversations have to begin very, very early. Also, ensuring the child that while this is happening to you or could happen, it is not the child who is to be blamed, which is why it is important for the child to report so parents or mommy daddy can take action about it. And this is the confidence that needs to be built within the child so that they are able to voice and they're able to report.
And I think the other side of the conversation is also important, in the sense that how do you tell your child not to be, you know, a bully online, right? So how their own behavior should not cross the line. Not only could they be victims, but they could be perpetrators of this behavior.
Absolutely. In fact, that is one of our major concerns. So no parent teaches the child ki ja bhai tu sabko bully karke aa, you know, can go and create ekdam traumatic experiences for other children. No parent would want to teach that. But we also need to understand that children are fighting a huge force of peer pressure. So while you are coming to school with values such as peace and love and, you know, all of these, there's an entire force there which is asking you to do just the opposite.
Right.
So where would a child want to be? Obviously on the other side, because that's where he or she belongs. And you know, children have told us incidences where they've said, "Mummy, daddy ko to baad mein pata lenge," but at that point in time, I need to be with my friends because they are the ones who I need to be with all, at least while I'm in school. And this pressure is extremely killing. And these kind of forces are very, very difficult to kind of keep at bay. That's when we're trying to talk to children about how to be strong and take a stand. And even if you're alone, the stand that you take is going to be critical to influence other children like you to be able to stand strong and say no, because you have the right and the power to say no, but there are consequences that will follow. And the consequences could be that you will not probably be accepted by a group, but would you then want to be a part of the group which is against the values that you want to believe in? And children understand, you know, children really understand even as young as 4 and 5 grade. But it is difficult because they're children and they want to probably be with friends. It is a very tough call, but we've seen a lot of children practice this and have become fabulous cyber safety ambassadors. In fact, we've had children from grade 4 and 5 who pledged not to play PUBG till they're 16, and they're going to influence all others because they realize that PUBG is 16 and plus. I think these influencers as children are our best tools and our best mascots, I would say. So working with them is very, very empowering.
So a couple of, you know, quick questions, Sonali. In terms of device addiction, what would you say is a safe time limit for a kid? And how do you de-addict a child who's become addicted to device screen time?
The WHO guidelines talk about no screen time exposure under 3. 3 to 6, 20 minutes. So 20 is the break limit for all devices for children at least up till 12, but I don't think that is possible. 6 year onward, we talk about 30 minutes as a cutoff, because nowadays in schools, the session are at least for 30 to 40 minutes.
Yes.
So with the schools online, we are not really looking at regulating screen time, which is educational, but regulating the screen time, which is meant for entertainment.
Right.
And that's the huge challenge that everybody is facing. So while children don't have to go out and don't know what to do at home, then if they are investing their time in entertainment online, that needs to be structured. Secondly, if they are playing online games, so you are aware of platforms like Peggy or ESRB, where parents need to decide what game a child should play, especially under the age of 12. Because the ratings that talk about, parents are hardly aware of game ratings. So while a rating is not just a thumbs up and a 5-star, a rating needs to tell you 4 important things. One is what is the age appropriateness of the game or the platform. 2, the amount of violence. 3, the amount of sexual content, and 4, the lessons that you learn or the outcomes of the game. And these cannot be selected by children because they obviously don't understand consequences. So understanding what to choose age appropriately for your child for entertainment is something that the parents must be educated about. And that is where they can play a role as introducing things to their children accordingly. For children above 13, 2 hours in a day is good enough, but they're learning at least for 4 to 5 hours a day. Again, I would say take a break after every 45 minutes that the session ends and don't go back to screens for entertainment. You're eating, make sure you're doing some physical activity alternatively, because everybody's sitting online for about 6 to 7 hours in a day. These are guidelines that WHO has given, but it is very difficult to follow them in the current frame of situation. So I think for parents, if you see things are going overboard, maybe you can look at providing some other alternatives. So what happens to cases that are reported for internet dependency or gaming addiction? We even had cases of pornography addiction with children as young as 10 years because they've accidentally visited some sites and then they have been glued to those sites. So that requires psychiatric intervention. I think we're not asking whether children are viewing porn. We're asking at what age, because some or the other exposure is 100% bound to happen. For example, if the child has seen you watching Netflix with some of the web series, the child is educated for life. You don't need any special education for the child to teach what sexuality and sex is all about. So conversing with the child as to what the child has seen and what is the child perceiving and understanding and demystifying those myths is very, very important at the right age. ऐसा नहीं कि आज देखा 10 साल के बाद यू ट्राइंग टू इंटरवीन एंड टॉक अबाउट इट्स नॉट गोइंग टू हेल्प एंड देयरफॉर काउंटर द बिलीव्स दैट दे हैव बाय लॉजिकल जस्टिफिकेशंस वी डोंट गिव लॉजिकल जस्टिफिकेशंस टू आवर चिल्ड्रन ऑल वी टेल देम इज डोंट डू दैट इट्स नॉट गुड फॉर यू एंड दे आर नेवर कन्विंस्ड अबाउट इट सो इफ वी आर रैशनली टेलिंग देम व्हाट इज राइट व्हाट इज रॉन्ग एंड गिविंग देम द पावर टू अंडरस्टैंड दैट आई थिंक थिंग्स विल इवॉल्व ओवर टाइम एंड वी विल नीड टू बी पेशेंट
Nali, thank you so much. There is so much more to discuss. I would like to, probably we will chat about doing another session. I also like to usually summarize, and pick up some of the key points. But I think the entire conversation has been filled with insights and key points. I would not do justice in terms of summarizing this. I really, really appreciate, your time today. It's been a pleasure. And thank you so much, Sonali. I've learned so much. I'm sure that parents and teachers and even children who listen to this video will take away so much about what they can do to keep themselves safe online. Thank you.
I think this doesn't end here. I'm sure there's so much to be done, and we're also looking at bringing people together to kind of advocate for the cause of child online protection, and this is a great start. So thanks for having me here, and we will certainly want to continue this further.
Absolutely. My pleasure. Thank you.